The highly anticipated bilateral between Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and US President Donald Trump on the sidelines of the G7 summit. A host of issues have been on the table. There's been wide-ranging speculation on what the key takeaways from that meeting will be. I also want to get an Ambassador Arun Singh to begin with first the dissection of the body language. I have to ask you to first comment on how, at least as far as the body language between the two leaders is concerned, the bonhomie seems to have gone a notch higher. Before we come to that, though, we have seen the reiteration of India's stance as far as issues between India and Pakistan are concerned, that they are purely bilateral, and Donald Trump also echoing that statement now.
This was a very important occasion because this was the first time that the Indian Prime Minister and President Trump were meeting face to face after India took action in terms of the changing the status of Jammu and Kashmir, although they had a conversation on telephone earlier. So it was important to use this occasion to convey clearly a message to the US President and internationally as to how India plans to move ahead. And I think so from that perspective, the Prime Minister using this occasion in front of the US President, directly in a sense to him, saying that as far as India is concerned, all issues between India and Pakistan will be handled bilaterally, not through any third party role, was important. Now, of course, from President Trump's point of view, he signaled while accommodating the Indian point of view that he remains focused on the issue of Kashmir. He said that last night he had discussed the issue of Kashmir with the Prime Minister. And once the Indian Prime Minister said that it would be handled bilaterally, he said if they are able to handle bilaterally, that is best. So leaving it a little open as to what he might want to do later. But I think this point has been established. And then if you saw the Indian Prime Minister in his comments went on to touch upon other aspects of India-US relations, the commonality in values, trade issues, economic cooperation, the role of the people of Indian origin, 4 million strong as a bond between the two countries. So he emphasized that. And then he said that as far as Pakistan is concerned, in his own conversation with the Pakistan Prime Minister after he had been elected, he had conveyed to him that we should work together to fight the common challenges of poverty, illiteracy, the economic challenges the two countries face. And that, of course, Pakistan has to deal with terrorism and the support that terrorism gets in Pakistan. So I think from India's point of view, our position was clearly laid out to the US President. And now we have to see how it evolves. And I'm confident that watching this interaction, Pakistan will not take much comfort from what has emerged from this meeting.
Absolutely. Significant heartburn in Islamabad ever since India made that crucial move. US President Donald Trump echoing the sentiment and the stance that India has taken on the issue all throughout. That has to be one of the key takeaways, apart from the fact that we've seen the two leaders meet for the second time this year itself. A lot has gone down the line in those 2 months that we've been talking about. In terms of the stance that the U.S. has taken, do you see a significant shift or does it come along expected lines?
I think U.S. stance, at least President Trump's stance, as one can say, gyrated, gone up and down. And so this is the stance today. This is the stance in this meeting. Now, what he will do after a tweet or after a couple of days, we have to see. On the subject of Kashmir, he has a couple of times said he's ready to mediate. Once he falsely claimed that the Indian Prime Minister had asked him to mediate, and that was completely denied from India. Subsequently, the U.S. administration let it be known that their position was that it is for India and Pakistan to resolve the matter, but they are ready to assist if both ask for it. And clearly India is not going to ask for it. But that having been said, while from India's perspective, US has no role to play on the substantive aspects of the issue, but whenever there is a sense of crisis, whenever there is a sense of any kind of regional tension building up, other countries do get active. And we saw that after Pulwama and Balakot. It happened in 2001 after attack on our parliament. It happened in 1999 after Kargil. So the message from the US including in terms of briefings that senior officials gave before this encounter, was that the U.S. would also like to understand from India what steps it is going to take to deal with regional tension. So that's one way of keeping themselves engaged with the issue, as it were, without doing any substantive mediation. So we will have to carefully see how this modulation plays out.
And he has chosen to bring up the issue of mediation as many as three times. The president has tried to come across as an activist on that front. But today we see a significant shift from that stance. And you're saying that that's the shift today. We don't know, of course, given how unpredictable he is, what things could look like tomorrow.
So I would say that the substantive U.S. administration position is that this is a bilateral matter between India and Pakistan. U.S. is ready to assist if both countries ask for it.
Yes.
But President Trump is playing his own game by his own rules. He wants to do things to incentivize Pakistan to be more cooperative to the U.S. in the context of Afghanistan, to getting the Taliban to talk to the U.S. and maybe get some deal between U.S. and Taliban. So he feels one way of keeping them incentivized is by showing some kind of activism or engagement on the issue of Kashmir. And then he wants to see a role for himself internationally.
Right.
He has tried to pick out issues where U.S. presidents have not played any role in the past because he wants to show that he's a different kind of president. So he's approaching Iran differently, he's approaching North Korea differently. And so he may be exploring if he can do something here which is different from what other presidents have done. But if he sees a severe pushback from India, and the fact that I recognize that he will not be able to succeed and he'll only end up damaging the U.S.-India relationship, maybe that will tone him down. Because way back in 2008, for example, President Obama, as a candidate in an interview to Time magazine, had said that perhaps U.S. should play a role in resolving the Kashmir issue and that perhaps a special envoy should be appointed. But when he saw severe pushback from India on this issue, then during his presidency, he didn't touch it at all. And when Richard Holbrooke was appointed special envoy, deliberately his mandate was restricted to Afghanistan, Pakistan.
Absolutely.
And did not touch India at all. So he absorbed that this was, you are unlikely to make any progress and you'll only end up damaging the U.S.-India relationship. And if the India relationship is important to the U.S., they have to stay away from that. So I think that message the U.S. administration understands. And we have to see how President Trump deals with his own impulses and the substance of the issues as they play out.
Impulses being key high point here, of course. We've been talking about the various impulses of the U.S. president for the longest time. But for those of you just joining us, the bilateral between Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and U.S. President Donald Trump, those images on your screens of that more than a warm handshake that the two have exchanged in France on the sidelines of the G7 summit. A host of issues, of course, have been on the table. The Kashmir issue has also come up during that press interaction, questions that have been posed to the Prime Minister, and India reiterating its stance that the issue of Kashmir is a purely bilateral issue. The Indian Prime Minister also saying that India and Pakistan will together resolve the issue, and we do not want to, quote unquote, trouble any country, as Kashmir is a bilateral issue. U.S. President Donald Trump there reiterating India's stance and also reiterating the words used by Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The president saying that they have spoken about Kashmir, and he says that Prime Minister Modi feels that the situation is under control and that they will also be, the U.S. will also be speaking with Pakistan. The president overall saying that they are sure that they will be able to do something that will be very good. That's the larger message that's coming in from that bilateral. On your screens are the images of the two also sharing a candid moment. What do you make of the body language that the two leaders have displayed today?
I felt in the beginning there was a bit of stiffness. And I think on our side also perhaps there was a wariness to see how the issues related to Kashmir or India-Pakistan issues would play out in the public domain, because a large part of the meeting in the beginning was taken up by questions from the media. And President Trump has been known sometimes to hijack an entire meeting just for responding to questions from the media with very little time left for the substantive bilateral discussions. So there was a bit of stiffness, but once that aspect played out, and at one stage, when our Prime Minister said that he would like to respond to media further after his discussions with the US President, and President Trump made that into a humorous aspect, saying that more substantive discussions are required, then the bad body language eased considerably. And President Trump reached out to the Prime Minister. Prime Minister responded. So I thought in the second half, there was a lot of comfort in the body language and the expression.
Right. And I also want to take a moment and take a step back and talk about the very presence of the Indian Prime Minister at the G7 summit. Coming after a personal invitation from the French President, India is not a member of the G7 grouping. So the Prime Minister being invited and being a part of the G7 summit and holding all of these bilaterals, there are more lined up. There have been several that have taken place over the last few hours. So what's your sense of the larger message that comes in through this, and how it's an indication of India's growing significance at the international stage?
At some of the G7 summits, there have been outreach events where non-G7 countries have been invited. Mm. In the past also, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh had gone to one such event when there was a 8+6 meeting where six non-G7 or non-G8 countries had been invited for that. So in this case, President Macron has clearly invited additional countries based on how France sees its priorities and also role in the international context. So some countries from Africa have been invited because France puts a lot of emphasis on its relationship with African countries, especially the Francophone African countries. So that was one focus. And second, France, I think, is putting a lot of emphasis now on the Indo-Pacific. And with India, for example, they have a joint strategic vision document for cooperation in the Indian Ocean region. And France is an Indian Ocean power. It's also a Pacific power with physical presence in those countries. So he has therefore invited leaders from South Africa, India, Australia and Chile, which span the Indian Ocean and the Pacific. So I think that's the next signal in terms of areas of cooperation where new focus is required, architectures of security where new effort has to be made, and a recognition of India's global role, India's role in the Indo-Pacific, and the importance that France attaches to the bilateral relationship. Because a few days before the G7, in a very unusual gesture, the Indian Prime Minister went for a bilateral visit and spent a couple of days in Paris and in neighboring area, and had a very detailed bilateral engagement with the French President, where they identified that going beyond the present areas of cooperation, which are defense, space and nuclear, they will now move on to digital and cyber security. Hmm. Again, reflecting the very intense and dynamic strategic partnership between India and France. So I would say the invitation to the Indian Prime Minister is a recognition of India's regional global role and the importance that France attaches to its relationship with India.
Right. And as far as the interaction between the two leaders that we just witnessed is concerned, do you think there came along expected lines? Would you say that there were significant surprises there? Between U.S. President Donald Trump and...
No, not surprises. I mean, one can always expect the unexpected from President Trump. Hmm. But the way this meeting proceeded, I would say that from India's perspective, it went off as well as it could have.
All right. All right. So just a quick roundup for our viewers who might just be tuning in. The bilateral between Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and U.S. President Donald Trump taking place on the sidelines of the G7 summit. A host of issues that we just discussed have been also speculated to be a part of those talks. But the Kashmir issue also has been spoken about at great length during that press interaction that the two leaders had. The issue of the U.S. President Donald Trump offering to mediate, that was a specific question that was posed to the American leader, to which he responded that and echoed India's sentiment there, saying that it is a bilateral issue. New Delhi, remember, has maintained its stance absolutely categorically that the issue of Kashmir is a purely bilateral issue between India and Pakistan. The Indian Prime Minister also using some very interesting words there, Ambassador, saying that they are hopeful that they will resolve the issues. All issues are bilateral, also talking about the shared struggles between India and Pakistan. What did you make of that choice of words and the tone and tenor there?
It was similar to what the Indian Prime Minister had conveyed in his letter to the Pakistan Prime Minister after Imran Khan had been elected, and also in the telephone conversation they had, that yes, there are differences between India and Pakistan, and some of the differences it may take time to resolve, but we have common challenges. Challenge related to the economic growth and the economic constraints, challenge of poverty. It would be better for India and Pakistan to work together to try and resolve those challenges. And the people of both the countries would benefit from that, rather than focusing on the differences. So that is the message India has been trying to convey. Pakistan, by contrast, as you've seen, has for some time, and even more intensely of late, been focusing on the differences, because they have political compulsions, their own political compulsions, to show that they are active on the Kashmir issue, and that since India has taken some very decisive steps, they are taking measures to counter that and show India in a negative light. So they are dealing with their own compulsions. But I think if they are able to convey to people in Pakistan that the challenge of poverty, addressing those challenges, would benefit also people of Pakistan. Pakistan is going through tremendous economic difficulty.
Yes.
It just came out that their debt now is more than their GDP.
Has exceeded the size of the economy, yes.
And they are having to borrow heavily from many countries, China, Saudi Arabia, UAE, from the IMF. So given that situation, there are other objectives and societal benefits that they would do better to focus on. I think that was the message of the Indian Prime Minister.
But the approach that's been taken by Islamabad all throughout, ever since India's Kashmir move, has been in sharp contrast to those expectations and to also the hope that the international community has. Pakistan has made failed attempts to try and rake up the issue at the international level, but has found no support.
So I think it is also related to their own domestic compulsions. Imran Khan, as people have pointed out, sees himself as weak politically. Many say that he's not really elected, but he's been selected by the Pakistan army. So he needs to show that he's active on this issue. And Pakistan has, from time to time, try to internationalize the Kashmir issue, because they feel that helps them domestically.
Right.
Also, the Pakistan army, the whole raison d'etre based on which the Pakistan army gets almost 50% of the budget and plays a dominant role politically, is that they're able to stand up to India, especially on issues related to Jammu and Kashmir. So if they are seen as not being very active, then the support they command in Pakistani politics and society would be challenged very severely. So again, they see that from their point of view, they have no option but to try and ratchet it up at the international level. So they have their own compulsions, and we'll have to handle that.
I will take a cue from what you just said. I'll just come back to you. Also joining us on the broadcast this minute is our principal diplomatic correspondent, Siddhant Sibyl, who's been tracking the very latest. Siddhant, it's a meeting that's been talked about. A lot of speculation, of course, has been doing the rounds. But as we were just discussing, the reiteration of India's stance and the words that have been used by U.S. President Donald Trump echoing India's sentiment and position being one of the most crucial takeaways here.
Well, one thing is for sure, that India and Washington has been able to clarify and make sure that the misunderstanding that was emerging in past few months, especially after US President Donald Trump mentioning mediation, has been cleared. In fact, India has made it clear and public in front of the US President now that when it comes to India and Pakistan, all issues are bilateral, something that India has been reiterating for a pretty long time. But today it was stated in front of the US President that let India and Pakistan solve their issues. In fact, the Indian Prime Minister talked about how both the countries can resolve many issues and take action against poverty. But now focus will soon come away from France and from America to here in Moscow, where the Indian Prime Minister is all set to visit in a few days' time for the economic forum. But before that, there are two important visits happening here in Moscow. One, of course, the visit of the External Affairs Minister of India, Dr. Jayashankar, and of course the petroleum minister. So clearly, when we talk about G7, when you talk about India's position in the world today, India is garnering that traction that perhaps 10 years ago India did not got. We saw how the Indian Prime Minister was on a three-nation tour where two Islamic countries conferred on him important and one of the highest awards. And then, of course, now in France, he is meeting the top global leadership. And just a short while ago, he met the U.S. President. That, of course, was the main focus of the entire three-country visit of the Indian Prime Minister. But now, the focus, of course, will be shifting to other countries as well. Russia, of course, has been a key partner of New Delhi and a country that was the first country to come out in support of New Delhi when it comes to Kashmir. We saw that how the Russian Foreign Ministry issued a statement and bagged New Delhi, saying that it is India's internal matter. We also know that inside that consultative meeting, which was called by the Chinese and, of course, the Pakistanis, the Russians, the Americans, the French and the British.
Right, Sidhan Sibyl helping us better understand what the ramifications of those statements made by the two leaders have been. Let's play out for you some excerpts from that interaction of Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and U.S. President Donald Trump on the sidelines of the G7 summit.
Bharat aur Pakistan ke sare issues bilateral hai aur isliye hum duniya ke kisi bhi desh ko in के लिए कष्ट नहीं देते हैं और मुझे विश्वास है कि भारत और पाकिस्तान जो 1947 के पहले एक ही थे, हम मिलजुल करके हमारी समस्याओं पर चर्चा भी कर सकते हैं और समाधान भी कर सकते हैं। भारत और पाकिस्तान के बीच कई बायलेटरल इश्यूज हैं और पाकिस्तान के प्रधानमंत्री के चुनाव के बाद जब मैंने उनको टेलीफोन किया था तब मैंने उनसे कहा है कि पाकिस्तान को भी गरीबी के खिलाफ लड़ना है, भारत को भी गरीबी के खिलाफ लड़ना है, पाकिस्तान को भी अशिक्षा के खिलाफ लड़ना है, भारत को भी अशिक्षा के खिलाफ लड़ना है, पाकिस्तान को भी बीमारी के खिलाफ लड़ना है, भारत को भी बीमारी के खिलाफ लड़ना है। हम दोनों देश मिलकर के गरीबी के खिलाफ लड़ें, हमारी असुविधाओं के खिलाफ लड़ें और हम मिलकर के दोनों देश की आवाम की भलाई के लिए काम करें। ये संदेश
I'm here. I have a very good relationship with both gentlemen, and I'm here if for any reason, but I think they can do it themselves. They've been doing it for a long time. Really feels he has it under control. I know they speak with Pakistan, and I'm sure that they will be able to do something that will be very good. We spoke about it last night at Gurdwara.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi reiterating New Delhi's stance as far as the issue of Kashmir is concerned, saying that it is a purely bilateral issue, also talking about the shared struggles between India and Pakistan. Ambassador Singh has been with us right here in the studios, dissecting each and every word used by the two leaders there. You were mentioning a little while back about the approach that Islamabad has taken, but at the same time how it comes along expected lines and it has made several attempts which have not turned out in its favor.
Also, India for a long time has been arguing with Pakistan that instead of focusing just on issues that divide us, let us work out areas of cooperation. Let us focus on expanding trade and economic relations. Because if you try to resolve issues on the basis of mood between the two countries today, it may be very difficult to resolve them because positions are frozen, there is a lack of trust, there is an element of hostility and adversarial positions. But if you are able to build an atmosphere of cooperation, working for the benefit of people in both countries, then going forward, it may become easier to resolve issues that appear difficult today. And that's the approach we have taken. For example, if you take the approach with China, we have a boundary issue that has not been resolved. Yet the two countries have worked to increase trade, economic cooperation, cultural exchanges, try and create a different framework and atmosphere for the relationship. But for its own reasons, for its own political compulsions, Pakistan has not been able to accept that approach. And they have tended to focus just on the differences that are there. And it's very difficult to make progress. And again, many have argued that unfortunately in Pakistan, it is the army that dominates. an elected government is driven by the desires and needs of the people, how to work for the welfare of the people. An army that dominates is not worried about welfare of the people. It's just looking at the security dimension of an issue. And therefore, they are not able to approach issues from the people's point of view. Mm. And I think that's the basic divide in the approaches that India and Pakistan have taken on their bilateral issues, which has made it very difficult to make progress from time to time.
Right. And the interesting irony here is that Pakistan makes all these noises to try and paint a picture to its domestic audience that it is making all the right noises, but Pakistan's economic crisis is something that is pinching the common man all the more than these issues, and that's something that Pakistan does need to work towards more than what it's doing right now, and which is something that the Indian Prime Minister also, in a way, you know, has suggested, that there are shared struggles that the two countries have, but look at the way in which the two countries have approached these struggles and the backward movement in a way that Pakistan has made towards those objectives.
The economic situation in Pakistan is very difficult, very low rates of growth, high rates of inflation. They're having to borrow from different countries, borrow also from the IMF. They have excessive debt. They need to look at resolving those problems instead of just looking at creating a huge army and trying to get armaments from different parts of the world, armaments from China, which is really a drain on their resources. But somehow, as I mentioned, for their own domestic compulsion, especially the preferences of the army and the dominant role that the army plays in Pakistan society, they have not quite been able to exercise that choice. Mm. And if way back in 1980, Pakistan's per capita income was the same or a little more than India's per capita income.
Right.
Today, it is way below India's per capita income. In 1980, many people saw Pakistan as an economy that was doing reasonably well. Today, it is seen as an economy which is in doldrums. And from that time, Pakistan has used terrorism as an instrument of state policy in Afghanistan, against in India. And instead of really achieving its objectives, it has also ended up destroying Pakistani society.
Right.
Look at the extremism, violence and terrorism within Pakistani society.
Mm.
So the option that Pakistan has exercised has also damaged Pakistan, and they need to move away from that. But with the kind of activism they are doing right now, trying to focus just on Kashmir, trying to generate international activism on Kashmir, while taking attention away from the kind of measure they are taking in Balochistan, the measure they are taking against people in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, and there have been a lot of reports of human rights violations there. So that is not really a path that would head them in the direction of addressing the needs and welfare of the people of Pakistan.
And how is Pakistan's behavior or approach to this issue over the last few weeks really affected its standing on the international stage, according to you?
It has made no progress on this international
right.
stage, because the only country that has to some extent supported them is China.
Yeah.
And China is doing it for its own reasons, because it finds that Pakistan is dependent on China. China also finds that Pakistan's adversarial relationship with India is in a sense useful to China, because it can use Pakistan in the India context. Because Pakistan is completely dependent on China, then Chinese companies get projects in Pakistan. Pakistan buys all its military requirements from China. There is potentially the Gwadar port that can be used by China also for military purposes. So for economic and military reasons, it helps China to have Pakistan dependent on it. And therefore, they signal to Pakistan that we will help you by trying to raise the matter at the UN Security Council. But the fact that they were not able to convene a formal meeting of the Council.
Right.
And they got an informal closed-door meeting, but even from there was no statement.
Hmm.
Either a statement, press statement or a statement by the President of the Council meant that China was not able to generate support within the Council for the kind of measure it was taking. And again, if you look at the Indian Prime Minister was received in UAE,
right.
Very warmly. He was given the highest award, received in Bahrain. and the reactions that have come from other Muslim countries. Again, Pakistan would have hoped and wanted that at least in, among the Islamic countries, it will get some support, and that is not forthcoming.
And look at the way its own Senate chairman has responded to those developments as well. A larger message here coming in that Pakistan has not behaved in the way that the international community also would have hoped. And as you're saying, the support that it has received has not gone down in its favor. No support, of course, that's come the way of Pakistan. We're going to leave it there for the moment. Ambassador Singh, thanks very much for helping us better understand what those statements made by the Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and U.S. President Donald Trump on the sidelines of the G7 summit really mean and signify, and what the larger message.